Today's lecture, if you go back to the first slide, is about the first six lectures have managed to cover all 14 billion years of the universe's history pretty easily. And so we have some spare time to dwell on some of the things that are more closely connected with the kind of research that theoretical cosmologists like myself do. And I'm going to try to interconnect that with all of the mysteries of cosmology that we've been talking about. But mainly, I just want to give you a sense, because the goal of these lectures is to give you... Is it dark enough in the room, by the way?
Yeah.
No?
No.
No. Darker? Okay. Better? Better?
More
light?
No.
More
no.
More dark.
No, we're all going to sleep.
All right. More dark. People have caught on. Okay. So the point of this, the next two lectures, so this one and next week, will be to talk about this week. I'm going to cover a bunch of different theories that have been popular in about the last decade or so that involve extra dimensions beyond the three large dimensions that we're all familiar with. And I'm going to try to explain why cosmologists are interested in that. So first of all, when I talk about extra dimensions, I should probably say, what's an extra dimension? And the idea is that, so we have this direction, we have that direction, and we have that direction, right? So there's three. Sometimes you call it x, y, and z. You're really sophisticated, you can go to spherical coordinates and call it r, theta, phi, or what have you. But the point is that every space, point in space, has three numbers that can specify it. Compared with other some other reference point. But so that's long good. Three dimensions has been good enough so far to describe all the physical phenomena we see. It's very plain. As a string theory, I've heard a string theorist say string theory is a theory of extra dimensions, which I'll be talking about today. And I remember a string theorist once saying, I think she was joking, but I'm not totally sure, that experimenters have told us. Have told us string theorists that three dimensions are a particularly interesting number to study. And so I don't think she was really meaning she had to rely on experimental physicists to tell her that. But one of the things that we do in physics, especially theoretical physics, is try to figure out how to say obvious things in a really generalized way. So that you can see where, if you want to change your assumptions, how to do that. And so one of the ways that we do that is in extra dimensions, instead of thinking of it being just the special three dimensions, you just sort of say, just start writing all of your equations as if the number of dimensions was freely chosen later. And then what you notice is there's a lot of equations where if you leave the number of dimensions free, that the fact that we live in four dimensions actually determines facts about what happens. And I'm going to be talking about what happens if you relax that assumption today, and where the physics can change if there aren't just three dimensions. Though we have to, of course, respect the fact that it better look like three dimensions most of the time, because as the experimenter noted, that's a particularly interesting number to study. And so, as with many things in life, extra dimensions come in three varieties, little tiny ones, medium-sized ones, which are closer to small than big, and then really, really big ones. And so big ones, by big ones, I mean the big ones that we are familiar with. And I'm going to talk about each of these and why people consider them in turn. But I just wanted to say, so with tiny dimensions, the idea is that you don't see the dimensions because they're so small that nothing we have can fit into them. And so that they just are little, they're like wrapped up little spheres on every point in space. And if you try to stick a point of a pin in, the pin would not be able to make it all the way. By the time it went into the extra dimension, it would be all out before it had a chance to go anywhere. So it's really, really small. And so then you might say, if we have other really big dimensions, why? How come we don't see them? So the idea there, the basic idea, is just that there's some principle that even though there's all these other extra dimensions, that we can't see them most of the time, but there might be some ways to see them in special cases. Anyway, let's go start with the tiny extra dimensions. Because historically speaking, these are certainly the first to be considered by physicists. And so in tiny extra dimensions, The phenomenon that we're that you need is something that's called, goes into the sophisticated, semi-sophisticated name of compactification, which just means making them really small. So it was back in the 1920s, actually, that Theodore Kluze and Klein, who's the first name that's alluded to me, first actually wrote down the equations that you would need to describe really tiny, how quantum mechanics would behave with your really tiny extra dimensions. So, you know, 1920s is pretty crazy. That they were very forward-thinking, or crazy or insane, maybe both. But their work, the Kluze-Klein theory, or as it's sometimes called, the Kluze-Klein reduction, is actually the cornerstone still of our study of extra dimensions. And so the basic thing that the Kluze-Klein theory was based on, and the reason why I call it a reduction, is the idea is that, so this cylinder here, you can imagine, is the long direction is one of our spatial dimensions. So, it's just one of these. And the idea is that every point in along this dimension, no matter where you are, then there's another tiny dimension that wraps around, like a little circle, like a little a loop, a torus, if you want to be sophisticated. And so the idea is that if you made this extra dimension big enough, you could sort of like imagine taking a pencil and pushing it in the extra dimension and having the pencil tip hit its own eraser as you push it into the extra dimension and back. And so it's not like the dimensions that we have now, but another way to envision it is this, if you had a long enough piece of string, you could wrap it all the way around the Earth, and you could have the string tied to its own bottom and wrap it around the whole Earth. And the idea is this, of this, these compact dimensions, there's this really, really small direction where you can go around. By small, I mean really, really small, like much smaller than the nucleus of an atom. Tiny. So if you have imagine such an extra dimension, what happens? And so what Kluze and Klein realized is that if the extra dimension is so tiny, it turns out you can write the theory in five dimensions. So we're always talking about three spatial dimensions plus one time dimension. So we live in four dimensions in the way we talk about it. And so if you have one extra, you go to a five-dimensional space. And so the very clever thing they realized is that because these dimensions are so small, then their characteristic, so basically that the new stuff that happens because of this extra dimension can be written in a way that looks just like a new thing in the four dimensions. And so this is actually a really ingenious thing to notice, because what they realized is that you could take the equations that have five dimensions in them and do something we call integrating out, which is where you take all of the new things that happen in the fifth dimension, and there's like because the fifth dimension is such a different size from the other dimensions, so that part, those are part of the equations break apart and are separate from the four-dimensional equation. So you have like a four-dimensional piece and then the five-dimensional piece, and they're two separate equations. And the insight is that you can take the five-dimensional equation and solve it on its own, and then put the answer from that back into the four-dimensional equation. And then all you have is one four-dimensional equation that's different from the usual four-dimensional equation. And so this is actually the technique that has been used ever since to study higher dimensions, because it turns out to be a pain most of the time to try to study extra dimensions, just because keeping track of three is hard enough. I mean, we can't find our keys, much less. Let's just find our particles in five dimensions. And so this trick where you can replace the extra dimensional physics with new four dimensional physics, this Kluze-Klein reduction, is a cornerstone of this study, which in sort of modern gussied up form is called effective field theory. And so what they realized, what Kluze-Klein realized, is that the most basic thing that happens when you replace an extra dimension with new four dimensional physics is that every particle, every like electron or photon, everything, gets a tower of new pairs or new partner particles. And so, and each of these partner particles has more mass than the previous one. And the spacing between the masses, in the simplest case, is given by 1 over the radius with 2 dimensionful constants, the Planck constant and the speed of light thrown in there, to turn a length into a mass. And so the idea is that the smaller the extra dimension, the bigger the mass gap between the partner pairs of these Kaluza-Klein partner particles. And so so that's the prediction, so that's the sort of most generic prediction of extra dimensions, is that you have a bunch of more massive particles that are paired to all of your low energy particles we already have. And you might wonder why that's the case. And so for that, we have to think just a second about what about quantum mechanics. And so remember, in 1920s, all they had really was quantum mechanics, and that was still pretty new. And so the easiest thing to think about is light, because the light, we're all familiar with thinking about light as a wave. And so the idea is that so the wave function, the wave-like behavior of light, if that wave is bigger than the extra dimension is, then that light does not care at all about the extra dimension. It can't see it, no effect. But what can happen is if you have a wavelength that's small enough for it to exactly go around the extra dimension once, then that's what we call a resonance. And so the wavelength, whenever it goes into the extra dimension, it exactly resonates. So it doesn't get dissipated by going around the extra dimension, but exactly the nodes at the nodes and the peaks at the peaks, and you get a trapped resonance in the extra dimension. And that trapped resonance, so that wave going up and down, hitting itself exactly in concord every time it goes around the extra dimension, in our four dimensions looks like a mass, because it's a trapped piece of energy. So this is a nice way of thinking about what mass is like, or it's energy that's trapped in a point. And that can happen for electrons, it can happen for any particle, because all particles have this wave-like nature. And so, so any time you have this special higher excitation of any of these particles, it can exactly reinforce itself in the extra dimension. Then you get a higher mass version of the same particle. And so this is Kaluza-Klein, what they call a tower of masses, because in principle you can make masses of, you can have it wrap around once, or you can have the wavelength be exactly half of the extra dimension, so it goes around, so it goes through a tractor cycle twice all the way around the extra dimension, three times, four times, what have you. And so in the Kaluza-Klein theory, they were hoping to use this to unify electromagnetism and gravity. It didn't work. But that was just because they were, in some sense, thinking too small. And so about 16 to 70 years later, it turned that the Kaluza-Klein picture grew up to be string theory. So we've all heard of string theory by now. You may even have seen this crazy picture on the left. And so this crazy picture on the left is the string theoretic generalization of this simple cylinder. And so it turns out that, so mathematically, string theory is a theory of a higher dimensional theory of physics, where you let the equations tell you how many dimensions you need to describe physics. As the name suggests, the one key starting point of string theory is that the fundamental particles are in fact strings, vibrating lines in space. And so this is what over here is trying to be pictured. So if you imagine taking some material like diamond, it has a chemical structure, and that chemical structure has a nuclear structure. The nuclear structure has a fundamental structure. These are quarks. And then the quarks and the electrons are in fact these vibrating strings. If you could have a microscope that would look tiny, small enough. And so then the question becomes, so can you just have these strings vibrating in four dimensions? And the answer is, very surprisingly to, I think, everyone who studied this, it turns out that the answer is that no, it's not consistent to have vibrating strings describe particles with four dimensions. It's really a technical reason why. The equations are simply inconsistent to use really tiny strings and only four dimensions to describe fundamental particles. And it turns out that there's two ways to make it consistent. You can describe some of the particles, like photons, by themselves in 26 dimensions. It turns out 26 is the magic number for those particles. And that's the simplest string theory. It's always the one you start by setting. So you start with 26 dimensions. But then if you would turn that, you can put the whole, you know, the whole shebang, you want to get all of modern, all of current physics into string form, you need 10 dimensions, 9 spatial ones in one time. Or 11. But basically 10. and as it turns out that to do this, what you find is that a simple cylindrical description of these extra dimensions doesn't quite really hold together. And so what you need is actually a very sophisticated geometrical shape that describes the winding together of these extra dimensions. And that's what that people have tried to represent here. And it goes under the mathematical name of a Calabi-Yau manifold. Calabi and Yau are two mathematicians. And they found a manifold. And a manifold is basically a sophisticated mathematical term for a geometric object and a generalized number of dimensions. And so you can say the tabletop is a two-dimensional manifold. If you want to be really associated at Thanksgiving.
Repeat that definition.
Please. Oh, so a manifold is essentially sort of a geometric object and a generalized number of dimensions. And don't tell your mathematician friends that I said that because I'm sure it's wrong. But it's that'll get you 90% of the way there. Certainly, if it's good enough for me and I made this for a living, then it's probably good enough for most people. Until you actually need it. I'm sure it has other more sophisticated definitions. Anyway, so this is the modern version of this Kaluza-Klein idea, where you have really, really, really small extra dimensions the big question in string theory is whether it's good enough to do this Kaluza-Klein reduction, just forget that you have all the extra dimensions and describe everything as if it were four-dimensional, or if there is any special thing that happens where you have to use all of the information of all the extra dimensions. This is actually an active debate in string theory, even now. There are some string theorists who say that when we find the final answer, we'll have to include all the string theory stuff. And those are people who say, maybe not. And so we don't really know yet, because string theory famously hasn't predicted, it doesn't predict much, just because it's so far away from our current understanding of low energy. But I just wanted to say that I said this thing about 26 and 10 extra dimensions. So it turns out you need to go from 26 extra dimensions to describe part of physics to 10 total. Sorry, not 26 extra dimensions, 26 total dimensions. Down to the mere 10 of modern string theory, they can describe all of physics. You need a new ingredient, which is called supersymmetry. And supersymmetry is an idea that was invented outside of string theory, where because of its nice mathematical properties, where you take the standard Markov model, which is pictured here, so up, down, strange, charm, bottom, and top quarks, photons, gluons, Z, and W bosons, the Higgs boson that we haven't found yet, the neutrinos, electrons, muons, and tau leptons. So this is all of the known particles, plus one that we expect is there but haven't found. And so basically, you take this whole set and you invoke a symmetry that says for every one over here you get a pair that is related in a certain way. And for simplicity of nomenclature, all of the particles just get an S in front of the name, so the quarks become swarps, the neutrinos become sneutrinos, the electron, the selectron, etc. And then all of the force particles, like the photon, get an eno at the end, so photons are paired to photinos. Gluons are paired to gluinos, and Z bosons are xenos. I really bring this up, not because I'm going to talk about it too much, but because it really is an important part of modern physics, and it has amusing names. Anyway, so you need the supersymmetry and plus the 10 dimensions to make string theory work. But there's one other thing I wanted to say, which sometimes, because it didn't make it into the name of string theory, it's forgotten that it's actually just as important as the strength of the string theory. And that is a discovery made by a physicist named Joe Polchinski, which is that if you have strings, and so one of the strings in string theory have two kinds. There's strings that are open strings, so they have two loose ends, and closed strings, where the strings close in on themselves. And if you have two loose ends, You might, what Joe thought about this, that if you have two loose ends, why are they should, you have to tie them down to something, because you have to specify in your equations how the ends behave in time. And so what he realized is that by specifying how the ends behave in time, what you've actually identified is a surface where those ends are tied down. And this surface is a higher dimensional object that you have to have for string theory to be self-consistent. And so he called these Dirichlet membranes, because Dirichlet is the name of a physicist from long ago who wrote down for ordinary strings how you, or for ordinary physics, how you write, how you talk about how the ends of strings behave. And Joe described how you would do this in string theory by describing these as membranes in space. And so what this is quite a revolutionary realization, because we now know that string theory has so strings, but also in addition to the strings, also these membranes or objects in any an arbitrary number of dimensions that are just as fundamental to string theory as the strings themselves. And so you have strings and they're tied onto membranes or brains. And so these brains are where the name of this lecture came from, because once you realize that there are these fundamental objects that have, you know, even a seven-dimensional brain or a three-dimensional brain. And I always think this is amusing. You can always tell string theorists who have a sense of humor by asking if they ever laughed about this. So you can talk about, people talk about three brains, five brains, seven brains. So the way they name it is a number, dash, number of brains. And so whenever they, physicists want to specify an arbitrary number without specifying in advance, you might usually say just, you might think you'd say D brains or N brains, or N for the number, D for the number. But those are sort of taken for other reasons. And so what they said was, let's call them P brains. So that was the reaction I had. But the very first time I went to a string theory talk, and they kept on saying, there was a very earnest young man from another country, and just kept on saying, and then we have the P brains. And I had trouble containing myself. But no one else seemed to think it was funny, so I'm glad that you did. Anyway, and so just one thing that I'm going to dwell on a bit later is that once you realize that these brains are fundamental objects, then it becomes one of the thoughts that comes to mind if you think about it, if you can have an arbitrary number of dimensions in a brain, what if you have a brain that say has three dimensions? That would be very nice. And then you can just say that. That's where we live. Our world is on one of these brains. And then all the extra dimensions are sort of like in addition to them. And so that's sort of the fundamental conceptual insight that we now rely on. So we say that we live on a brain that has three dimensions. And then the rest of string theory goes in these other directions. But the other thing I wanted to say is, so these open strings start and end on a brain. But I talked about these closed strings. And so closed strings clearly don't need to end anywhere, so they can float. They don't have to sit on top of a brain. And so it turns out very interestingly that these closed strings are the ones that describe gravity in string theory. And all the open strings describe everything else. So, and this has become very interesting because gravity is, as you know, really different from the rest of the other forces. The one we understand the least well. It's by far the weakest force. And so this is one of the reasons why, sort of at the qualitative level, a lot of people have hope that string theory really is the right theory for describing gravity, because just at this purely geometric, like, first line in the public lecture level, so the gravity is really special and a different kind of force. It's the only one that's described by these closed strings as opposed to the open ones. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. And so I just want to say, so now that you have all these extra dimensions, you might wonder what you can do with them. And so I'm just going to, basically the rest of the lecture is going to be examples of ways where people have taken extra dimensions to tell a new story that you couldn't tell as easily and without the extra dimensions. And so one of these, and actually this is not in time earlier than many of the other ones, but it connects well to the string theory story, is an idea called brain inflation, which was come up with by this physicist Gita Devali, who was then at NYU, And he's now at CERN and the Max Planck Institute in Germany. And Henry Tide was a string theorist at Cornell University and was also one of my PhD supervisors, so I know him all. And so they had this idea that it was one of the very first successful theories of inflation using string theory. Is that basically, remember the idea in string theory is you have to have something holding vacuum energy so the universe could inflate. And then at the end, that energy would have to get dissipated somehow. And so what they said is, well, it turns out that these brains, these membranes, work sort of like particles in our space, and they're actually attracted together. So if you have just if you put a couple of brains in space, then they'll get pulled towards each other because you can have strings, two open strings that end on the same brain, or you can certainly imagine you can take a string from one brain, stretch it to the other brain, and then that stretched out string pulls the brains together. And so that's nice, because that's a way of storing energy in an extra dimension. And it turns out to work pretty well, this for describing inflation. And then you also have this elusive, graceful exit from inflation, a natural way to have inflation go on and then have a big boom of energy at the end. So you have two huge brains coming together, and they're making inflation happen while they fall together. At the end, obviously, they hit. And so what happens when two brains strike each other is that they annihilate each other. There's a big string theory explosion. And so that would be a natural way for inflation to terminate, is that you have brains that basically ram into each other and make a big boom. And so, so this is something that people are still trying. So it turns out that basic picture is very nice. Getting all the details to work out has taken dozens of string theorists, about a dozen years now. People are still working away at all the technical details, but it's a really interesting idea. And it uses, in this fundamental way, these extra dimensions, which is a nice thing. So,
yes. What is inflation?
Okay, so the inflation was the subject of the second lecture. It was the period that preceded the hot beginning of our universe, when the universe expanded by a factor of 10 to the 30 in size. And we know that a period like this took place because of observations we made in the early universe. So it's a fact, but a very puzzling fact about modern physics.
How long did it last?
Very short, 10 to the minus 39 seconds. Okay, so up till now I've talked about really, 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 really tiny extra dimensions. So the string theory extra dimensions are characteristically, it's hard to even express it in normal units, but it's just really small, unimaginably small, much smaller than the biggest particle accelerators we ever built could probe. So really small. And so in the last 10 years, though, people have thought about having larger extra dimensions. And the reason why is that, I was making some hay of this fact that in string theory, the gravity is described by these closed strings. They can float off of the brain. And that's interesting from the fact that gravity is a really, really, really weak force. And so if you compare electromagnetism to gravity, for instance, electromagnetism isn't that different in strength from the weak nuclear force. But electromagnetism is 10 to the 32 times stronger than gravity. And we all know this, even though we don't think about it very much, because just think about it, I'm holding this little remote control up. And so the electrons, like a sort of a handful of electrons, if you will, nobody got the joke, a handful of electrons, is supporting this electron. Meanwhile, the entire Earth's gravity is pulling down. And the hand is, and, you know, the electrons are easily winning. You can imagine balancing this on the tip of your finger. It's not like the electrons are going to lose. And so the upward push of the electrons, which is an electromagnetic force, so something that can blow your mind is that except for gravity, everything, all of chemistry, every piece of normal physics that we ever do or experience in our entire lives is all electromagnetism. It's kind of mind-boggling, but true. Anyway, so the electromagnetic force is way stronger than gravity. So planets versus your finger wins is the problem. And so this is a great puzzle, actually. So all the other forces are sort of close to each other, factors of 10, 20, something like that. A factor of 100, maybe. But they're not radically different. The gravity is radically different. And this it has a sophisticated name of the hierarchy property. And so the idea is that, so if we have these extra dimensions, and we have this thought from string theory that we can make gravity treat the extra dimensions in a special way, then what if we have gravity just go off into some extra dimensions, keep all the other dimensions in our space, and then basically say gravity is weak because it's just flowing out into these extra dimensions. And that's the explanation for why gravity appears to be so weak. That in fact, gravity is just as strong as just the gravitons just shoot off in extra dimensions, and so we don't catch them. And so the main theories that do this are called large extra dimension theories. But by large, I still mean pretty small. And so the original of these theories, the extra dimensions are between a millimeter and a micron approximately. And so just to remind you, so that a human hair is 75 microns. Micron, just 1,000 microns are in a millimeter. We can see a millimeter. Human hair, so these would be extra dimensions that are about the size of human hairs, or pollen, dust, E. coli. So stuff that's sort of familiar, but pretty tiny for real life. But that's still pretty big. So if you imagine having new extra dimensions at like a millimeter, it's kind of mind-blowing. And so the people who really wrote down the first successful way, the first successful theory for having large extra dimensions were these three guys. So Nima Arcani-Hamed, Gia Davali again, and Savas Demopoulos. And so I should say that you're going to see Gia up here popping up all over the place. And he is probably the most creative user of extra dimensions in the world. He's a very famous physicist now. If you ever had the chance to hear him give a lecture, I would highly recommend it, because he is probably the most entertaining physics lecturer I have personally ever heard. And Nima is also, it's actually, between these students, it's a pretty close tie for entertainment body. Both because they're crazy and because they're brilliant. Anyway, so these three guys, and these two, at the time, postdocs were looking for jobs, and so we're very lucky to come up with one of the most popular models in the history of particle physics. Basically realized that there is no reason you couldn't have an extra millimeter-sized extra dimension that only gravity saw. So no one ever thought of this before. And so this is popularized in this way, where you just have these little millimeter-sized extra dimensions at every point in space. And so this is written, so this is slightly misleading because it looks like space is on a grid. There's no indication that space is on a grid, but you can just imagine literally every point in space having a chunk of extra dimensions. And you have to have at least two. I think in my theory they have maybe two or three. Because you have to have a volume, or you have to have volume in the extra dimensions for the gravity to spread out. And so basically the realization was, and you can actually visualize this dilution of gravity in a very simple way. And so it turns out the reason that we have a 1 over r squared force law for gravity, that Newton's force goes like 1 over the distance squared, is because we have three spatial dimensions. So if you had four spatial dimensions, Newton's law would be 1 over r to the 1 over r cubed. And so gravity would fall off faster in more dimensions. And the generalization of that is that if you have d total dimensions, then you go from 2 to d minus 1. So a six-dimensional space, it's 1 over r to the 5, et cetera. And so what you can see then is that basically gravity is going to be, if this is the intrinsic force law in the extra dimension, then when you get down to a millimeter or so, then you're going to see a very different force law for gravity. Gravity is no longer going to be going like 1 over r squared as it does on these long distances, but like 1 over r cubed. And so even though when you're going out to long distances, 1 over r cubed goes down faster, if you think of it going the other way, then that means that gravity is going to get a lot stronger when you get very close to r equals 0. Because, just think about it, so if you take r to be 0.1, then 1 over r squared is 100. But 1 over 0.1 cubed is 1,000. So for once you get to a small, whatever it is, small, tiny, to tiny numbers, then the gravitational force, if there are extra dimensions, is a lot stronger. And that's why it's the sort of the counterpoint to the gravity getting weaker on long distances. And so there's actually, because of this, essentially, there's these experimental groups who have come up with very clever, brilliant ways for looking for these extra dimensions. And so, M. Hamelman, which I should stipulate. But basically, the best group is at the University of Washington. And they basically use, so some of you may have remembered learning in physics class, but the way that we measure the gravitational force, the strength of the gravitational force, is using something called a torsion pendulum. So the basic idea is that you have, right, is that you have sort of a bar in space, and then two weights by the bar, and the bar is being supported by a wire or something. And so essentially you can see what you can actually measure, and this is really cool, is that you can see that this bar is being torqued, is being pulled away, pulled by these two spheres. And you can measure that pulling and use that to measure how strong gravity is. And so and this is called the Erdős experiment. And so what these people at Washington have done is come up with these really brilliant generalizations for this simple bar and spheres design that are essentially really, really finely machined apparatuses like this, where you have different metals that are with holes dug out of them, and they get very close to each other. And you can work out that you can exactly balance all of the gravitational forces except for the ones that are only operating on a very tiny distance scales. And so they can use this to measure how strong gravity is on, say, a millimeter scale, a tenth of a millimeter, a hundredth of a millimeter. And so they're constantly improving these measurements. And you can, and basically what you look for is for the force of gravity to bend, to twist this. And you can see this twisting by bouncing light off of a mirror. So you can basically remove the bottom part, and the light's going one place. You can move the bottom part in, and it feels the force of gravity, and the whole thing twists enough, you can see the light move. It's really amazing. But they haven't done any extra dimensions yet, unfortunately, for ADD. But the prediction of this theory that's much more famous is that another thing that happens whenever gravity is weaker, or whenever you have extra dimensional gravity, is that it becomes easier to form black holes. And so in normal four-dimensional gravity, it's very hard to make a black hole, because you have to get a lot of energy into a very small space. But it turns out that if you have these extra dimensions, then basically the energy cost to making a black hole goes down really rapidly, because essentially it's easier. The physics are a bit detailed, but you can essentially, it's the force of gravity is in a sense weaker relative to the number of dimensions. And so it turns out that black hole formation gets way easier. And so in fact, for some of these models, you could imagine the Large Hadron Collider or even Fermilab making black holes in the laboratory where they annihilate protons. And so this caused a lot of people to get nervous, because black holes are kind of scary, and you know, people worried about the whole Earth getting eaten by these black holes. And they would be so small, this is not really a problem. But just to be safe, actually, there was an official conference sponsored by CERN. They got all the people who thought about this together, and they said, just check your calculations again, just to be safe. We don't want to destroy the Earth. I had friends who went to this conference, and they all agreed, it was all safe, but they really did check, to be double sure. But as you know, the Large Hadron Collider has turned on, and they have not made any black holes. And so in the most interesting versions of these theories, they would have already made black holes in Switzerland. But they haven't, so it's kind of too bad, because it would have been really amazing if they had made some black holes, but they didn't. But you know, you never know, it could still happen. And so one other model like this I wanted to highlight by another Canadian physicist named Cliff Burgess, a picture here. And this is one that doesn't get talked about in the popular media very much, but it actually does as much for you, I think, as this ADD model, which has been in Scientific American like a dozen times. But because it doesn't make black holes, then no one cares. So he calls it Rosebud, or SLED. So it's SLED stands for supersymmetric large extra dimension. And it's a string theory model. And so in this model, basically the idea is that you have a brain on over here, four-dimensional, and that's where we live. And then you have two big extra dimensions, like micron size extra dimensions, and then they go over and basically attach onto some other brain over here. And the other thing that they call this is the rugby ball model, because it turns out that the shape of these extra dimensions, which comes out of the mathematics, looks a heck of a lot like a rugby ball. And so this is a really cool model. And as you can actually, because of the cleverness of this symmetry of this design, you can actually solve all the equations, even in string, not all the equations of string theory, but you can approximate their solutions really well, which is a very, very, very rare thing in string theory models. And so it's one of the very few models that I know of that makes predictions both for large-scale structure, and you know I couldn't get through a whole lecture without showing this slide, and makes predictions for the Large Hadron Collider. So basically, it makes new it predicts that there are new particles that you'll see at CERN, and that there will be new physics both during inflation and at late times that can be observed. And so it's a really cool model that I wish Cliff would promote more. Well, he promotes it in physics circles a lot. So anyway, I just wanted to highlight that because I think it's really neat. And this shows that this is the kind of really clever things that people come up with, these kind of models. And so another model with these large but not so large extra dimensions that is also quite famous is this one by Lisa Randall and Raman Sundrum. So this is their response to ADD. So their model came out a year after the Arkani Hamad Duvalli Demopoulos model, because they thought that was an ugly model apparently, and also wanted to be famous themselves, because you know you can't get famous from someone else's model. And so their idea was having these tightly compactified extra dimensions. You know, the ADD people didn't have a story about why the compact dimensions should be like that. They just said, well, what if they were? And what Randall is, the brilliant breakthrough of Randall and Sundrum was the idea that you could have us, again, living on this brain, living in our four-dimensional space, and then have extra dimensions that had a phenomenon that they call warping. And that's essentially where it turns out you're allowed to do this in gravity, where you basically have a principle, a mathematical principle, that basically makes the effective size of the extra dimension change dynamically in time, so that basically it kind of traps everything to live close to the mother brain on which we live. And even though there's a whole lot of space out there away from the brain, and nonetheless this warping of space, this warping of the extra dimension, holds everything close to the brain on which we live. And so this is a way of introducing large extra dimensions, and yet making everything we know and love stick close to the four dimensions we know and love. And so they basically came up with two things to do with this idea. One was where you had two brains nearby each other, and it was warping between them that allowed one of the brains to be a very high energy brain, where gravity essentially moved, and then the other one to be a low energy brain where we lived. And so you could also solve this hierarchy problem, this weakness of gravity problem in this model. And then they realized that because of this warping thing, they could actually take the heavy brain and just kind of throw it out to infinity, and then use this fact of this warping to hold everything, all the regular forces, close to our brain. But then gravity could still escape enough to solve this problem. And so this model by itself has sort of, I don't want to say it's fallen out of favor, but people kind of did what you could with it, and it's sort of just waiting around for experimental observational tests, because it does make some predictions that the Large Hadron Collider can see. But the real sort of impact, I would say, of the idea is that string theorists caught on to this idea of warping, and it revolutionized string theory, basically, because what they realized is these Calabi-Yau manifolds, those crazy things that I showed you, so one of the things about them is that when you write them down mathematically, they are, every place in space is sort of the same as every place else. They have these crazy things where the curvature is always the same no matter where you are. So that means there's no real special places in space. And that's kind of, you know, mathematicians love that sort of thing. But for physicists, that's bad news, because string theory naturally wants to have everything happen at really high energies. But obviously, and by really high energies, I mean tens of orders of magnitude higher energies than the stuff that we observe. And so that's one of the reasons for string theory's famous difficulty in describing regular ordinary physics. Because all of our particles are really light compared to the string theory scale. But with warping, what they realized is that what you could imagine doing is if you get a bunch of these brains, you stack up these brains next to each other, what they do is they actually cause this warping effect. The brains themselves are the origin of this warping effect. And so they basically take a little piece of this perfectly symmetric Calabi-Yau space and call it something that the string theorists call throats. And basically they, it's, you can just kind of imagine putting taking a stretchy sack and putting a really heavy weight of it stretched down in one particular place where the heavy weight was. And these braids are like these heavy weights that stretch out pieces of the Calabi-Yau manifold. And then basically the idea is that we could live in one of these throats where the things are behaved differently from the smooth, perfect Calabi-Yau. And so this idea of warping has allowed string theory really to describe something that looks more like the real world. Though today, no one has still exactly made a precise string theory model that can actually describe just the physics of this, of our standard model plus nothing else. So they're still working. And so the last thing I wanted to talk about was something also that sort of came out of this Randall Sundrum idea. And that basically, there's this realization that if you, in this case, when you take the extra brain and sort of pull it out to infinitely far away, is that people thought, started thinking about, well, wouldn't it be kind of fun if you had an infinite size extra dimension? And there was the problem with that, let me just go back to one slide. The problem with an infinite extra dimension is essentially this, comes from this, remember I started the talk by talking about Kaluza and Klein, and the Kaluza-Klein reduction. And so essentially what happens is that because you want to be able to describe the physics in four dimensions, you always have to figure out a way of talking about this extra dimensions in terms of our four-dimensional physics. And if you have an infinite size extra dimension, when you try to do this procedure, then all four-dimensional physics breaks down. And so, basically, what you find is that you have that if you just try to have one infinite extra dimension without doing any special fancy working or anything, then it's not possible to reduce that to a four-dimensional theory. You're just stuck in five dimensions. And since we know we don't live in five ordinary dimensions, you can do it. And so that was why for a long time, people never tried to think about, I mean they tried, but they failed to think about infinite size extra dimensions. But what happened was, after this warping story, people started thinking more creatively about what you could do to actually realize an infinite size extra dimension. And there are a few theories that were proposed. But then the one that really caught on was this one that was, again, our old friend Guilla de Volta, and two of his colleagues at NYU, Gregory Gavadazzi and Massimo Corradi, wrote down this model that's called the DGP, de Volta, Gavadazzi, Corradi model. And as you can totally guess, the really successful models are ones with three people whose last names form into a nice acronym. And so the idea of the DGP model was, I think it was just as surprising to them as anyone that this worked out. Because you have a brain where we live, and also the five dimension, and then the fifth dimension, so the infinite size extra dimension. And the novel thing that they said is that, well, let's just say that we have a four-dimensional theory of gravity and a five-dimensional theory of gravity simultaneously. And we just say that they have to agree, so the two theories of gravity have to match up whenever you go onto our brain. And it turns out that,
why can't you use infinite equation and have any kind of little game of physics?
Oh, so we talk, I mean, all the time we do that. So we treat our special dimensions as infinite in size. All the time. It's not a problem.
I understand that you're saying that, but I always heard that when you get to infinity, that was everything breaks down.
So if you have infinity appear in the equation, that's a problem. But if you have an actual phenomenon that an actual spatial dimension that has infinite size, that's not a problem. Because all of our equations describe things that happen nearby.
So you can't describe this in any equation.
Oh, you can. The trick is that by infinite extra dimension is that there, in every previous case, I had to put a size in for the extra dimension. That explicitly appears in the equation. And in that case, essentially any place where you had 1 over L before, where L is the size of extra dimension, you just say L goes to infinity and this goes to 0. And so infinity is fine as long as it's 1 over. But there's a deep truth to that, actually. Anyway, so I understand your concerns. It really is okay. And so basically, so this is the idea. And magically, just having gravity twice, no one had ever tried putting in gravity twice in the same theory before. One time in the first four-dimensional version, and once in a five-dimensional version. And lo and behold, it worked really well. And what they realized was that if you did this, then you could have the four-dimensional gravity essentially leaking off of the brain. And so a way to visualize this is from this picture from Nia Deval, a talk of Nia, is that if you imagine that you're a bug that lives on the table, say you were an insect living on this table, you didn't know about three dimensions. All you just looked down all the time, so you just saw a two-dimensional space. But you were a physicist bug, and you heard a knocking sound in your space. Then if you were near where that knocking sound started, and you started studying how the sound waves propagated, then really close to where the knocking starts, those sound waves are getting softer along the surface of the table, as if they were in two dimensions, because the sound waves nearby where they start are confined to the surface of the table. So they'll be falling off like as if they're in two dimensions. But obviously there are three dimensions in this room. And so as you get further out, as you go farther away from the source of the vibrations, then those vibrations, the bright vibrations in the table start exciting vibrations in the air, which is how it gets to all of our ears. And so the energy starts dissipating faster whenever you get to larger length scales. And so if you were the physicist bug, you'd be very puzzled because you say, okay, when I'm really close to the sound, then it sounds like I'm living in two dimensions. But if I go farther away, then the sound is getting soft too fast. There must be something else out there that's allowing the sound to get softer, faster. And so the idea of DGP is that gravity is telling us a similar story. And that the reason why we see this acceleration on the largest length scales is because the gravitational force itself is leaking out on very long length scales where it's realizing that there is this extra dimension out there. But on short length scales, like where we do our usual observations, we just see four-dimensional gravity. And so this is linked to the other sort of new thing that came out of this model, which is the idea that the brain on which we live could actually have ripples in it. And so in the previous models for these brains, and in most of the string theory models for the brains, the brains are they can in principle ripple, but they're extremely rigid. So just because of the mathematical structure of the theory, you need the brains to be really just stiff. But it turns out to make this model work, the brains have to be kind of not that stiff, as it turns out. And so what you get is an equation for the brain bending, the sort of ripples of the brain that we live in. And it turns out that this brain bending mode is the one that causes all the interesting new phenomena. The brain bending is what basically connects the four-dimensional physics with the extra-dimensional physics. And what that leads to actually is an extra force of gravity. that extra force of gravity, it's actually really related to the subject of the next lecture, which is why I'm ending with UGP. And we'll pick this up again next week. But it turns out this extra force of gravity is really weak inside the solar system, but it would get bigger outside of the solar system. But it's not zero inside the solar system. So it turns out one of the really cool things that came out of the DGP model was that you could test to see if there was this extra dimension of gravity by looking at the moon. So here's a picture, these guys on the moon. And so one of the things that they brought to the moon, on the missions to the moon, was something called, there's a little mirror. They left this mirror there basically so that we could send light from Earth, bounce it off the moon, and then catch it back on Earth. This is called lunar laser ranging. And someone was clever enough to figure out that essentially if you could bounce light off of the moon, then you could, because we could measure light really well, you could find out the distance from the Earth to the moon now to like a centimeter, so really accurately. And so And the story goes, and I'm not sure if this is apocryphal or not, that the physicists or the NASA engineers who thought of this said, you know, what would work really great is if you got this, essentially the material they use for bicycle reflectors, and it would cost like $10. And so this is the proposal. And NASA being NASA, they commissioned a study to find the, you know, ultimate reflectors. And essentially they came up with, they came back with something that was just like bicycle reflectors, but cost $50,000. And I'm sure that it's, you know, much tougher to withstand the rigors of the moon or whatever, but some of those classic stories. Anyway, and so we do this all the time. I mean, so me, I, but you can, people bounce light off of the moon and measure it. And so it turns out that they're getting better and better at this. And so you can actually test this theory by, if you can get really precise measurements of the Earth-Moon distance and watch how that changes over time. Because it does change over time in general relativity, but we can predict it really accurately. And so it would be, evolve in time very slightly differently in this model. And so it's just, I think that's a really, really cool way of testing gravity. And with that, I'll end for today. Thanks for watching. Thank you. Before I take questions, I just want to remind people that two things. One, you can leave now if you want. Two, if you want to come to the luncheon and have not gotten a sign-up form, there are some up in the front. If we run out of them, just let me know, and I'm sure I can get some more or give you the information so you can get in contact with people on your own. Okay, thanks. All right. Okay. Time-like instead of space-like. So people have played around with this idea of making in the string, in the particular case of string theory, all the work was done explicitly thinking about this fact that you need nine dimensions. Those are explicitly space-like. You need nine space-like dimensions for those things to work. Because time-like dimensions are funny. And so, the reason time-like dimensions are funny and why it's hard to add more than one is because of causality. So, it's straightforward enough to say what time it is. And basically because, so, we think about, in special relativity, we talk about things being simultaneous if they're connected by the speed of light. So the speed of light sort of sets a special relationship among different space-time points, right? And so that works because there's only one time to measure that distance. As soon as you have two times to measure that distance, then you have a fundamental ambiguity about what you say is what caused something. And that turns out to there's no reason in principle why you couldn't figure that out, but in practice, no one knows. I mean, it's just, you basically get a nightmare, and no one's figured out anything. So if some ADD people came up with a really cool fact that you got from adding an extra time dimension, then we would think about it more. But no one's ever come up with a cool fact you can do with
all of them, like something besides time and
No, you're basically stuck with just time and space.
Yeah, so there's 30. You're stuck with one.
Yeah, basically, the way to think about it is that with distances, you can either have a distance in this dimension either add to the distance or subtract from the distance. And so when you're adding up how far two points are from each other. And basically, the difference between time and space is that all spatial dimensions make the distance further, and time makes the distance shorter. And so that's what's called a Lorentzian manifold. So it's one where there's one direction that comes up with a negative sign. And so that's essentially the statement in general relativity, so light goes along what's called null geodesics. And that means that the distance that light travels as seen by light is always zero, because its distance that it travels in time is always exactly equal to its distance that it travels in space. And so the net distance that it travels is always zero, when talked about in this way. And so again, and so you can't have anything other than those two.
Still think time is sort of mystery.
Oh yeah, I agree with that. Yes, sir.
Your test the moon experiment here. This is not just testing like Newtonian physics, like
right.
Okay, the moon is slowing down. Could you just elaborate a little bit what it is testing? It's a way to test this like linkage of gravity.
Mm-hmm. Right. So basically, in this theory, it's the precession of the perihelion of the moon. So the moon, so as you may recall, the moon's orbit, like all orbits, is not exactly spherical, not exactly circular. It's slightly elliptical. And so basically the sense of that ellipse slowly changes in time. So it starts out like this and then goes like this. And so we can basically, by tracking the location of the moon, you can see how fast that ellipse is moving, how fast that the angular location of the ellipse shape is changing in time. And so there are slowing effects that come from tidal effects, etc. But basically all of that is related to the strength of gravity. And so it's essentially Newtonian, but it has a small general relativistic correction, which you can calculate. And so this extra force would be another small correction, which you can calculate. And it turns out that it would just change it a little bit. And it would just change the prediction, so the perihelion would either move slightly faster or slightly slower.
Have they found any, some of the other experiments said, hey, they're trying to do this, they haven't got results yet. Mm-hmm. They got results from this.
Well, they haven't seen any deviations from general relativity, which puts a limit on how, on the size, essentially the characteristic size of this extra, of so the new thing you have to put into these equations is a distance at which gravity starts to notice there's an extra dimension. And so the failure to see anything beyond GR in these experiments tells you that characteristic size has to be at least 4,000 megaparsecs. Other questions?
You mentioned two large brains mm-hmm. coming together and exploding in energy. Could that be an example of particle-antiparticle meeting?
Mm-hmm. That's a very good conceptual point. So it's talking about this brain inflation theory that I mentioned, that the brains annihilate. And indeed, what I didn't say was that that's actually a brain and an anti-brain. So the analogy goes just straight through. It's just like particles annihilating. So brains have anti-brains, and brains and anti-brains, when they get together, annihilate the energy. So brains have anti-brains. Yes, sir. You. Yes, sir.
Several of your predecessors have given a whole bunch of series on string theory, and I think the last one of which a large portion of one of the lectures was devoted to trying to give analogies or explanations of how these extra dimensions could be so small that they wouldn't be observed.
Okay.
Which you get one today. And I was struck at the time that I could not figure out. Well, it seemed to me that all of these explanations were subject to the question of, with the magic of mathematical magic of scaling down in three dimensions, this example didn't seem to me to say anything that could have been completely described by scaled down three-dimensional descriptions, spatial dimensions. And you talked about your circles or spheres everywhere in space. Mm-hmm. The pencil going in and coming out at the eraser or something mm-hmm. like that. I'm not sure if it's, can you say something about how this requires an extra dimension, this smallness, that can't be explained in three dimensions? I don't know if that's a good question, then I'll try.
Okay, that's fine. So maybe an easier way to think about it would be, so I have something that we, to be honest, all of us physicists struggle with this too. It's very hard. Our minds are set up for three dimensions, how many we experience. To kind of kick yourself into thinking about extra dimensions in any kind of sort of intuitive way is very difficult. And it does remind me of something, and just to just kind of give an anecdote before I answer your question. The Gita Dwali, the one who keeps on coming up with these models, his Gita I have now is a really good intuition for what kind of new physics can be described using extra dimensions. And so what he says always is that you say, you might ask me why I'm introducing extra dimension. And I say that, and he says that what I say is that I see this phenomenon, if it quacks like a duck and it walks like a duck, then it's a duck. And so these new phenomena look like extra dimensional phenomena. He describes them that way. And in some sense, the right answer to your question is to say, the intuition of extra dimensions is that it's the kind of place where gravity goes when it leaks out of our dimensions. And so these physics examples where we actually use the extra dimension are actually, in a sense, the right thing to picture, but they're not the intuitive thing to picture. So that being said, a way that I like to think about extra dimensions is basically to imagine if you had another extra dimension that was just as big as ours, but that only you could go into. But not none of your friends. And so then our world would essentially be at one, so it would be like at point A in that extra dimension. But there's many other points in that extra dimension. And so and everyone else except for you has access to only point A in that extra dimension, because that's the only point in that extra dimension that they see. And so your whole three-dimensional body has, so my fingertip has three locations here in our space. Plus, it's at point A. And every other piece of my body has three locations in our spaces. And each point of the body has a different location in these three dimensions, right? But they all have the same location in the extra dimension. So they all have in the same way that my whole body is simultaneously existing in time in front of you. So also, my whole body would have the same location in the extra dimension. And so what you could imagine doing is just moving, just even very slightly in your extra dimension, and your whole body, and then to the rest of the world, if you can't see that extra dimension, you would just disappear. Because your whole body's, the extra dimensional spatial location of your whole body would be A plus 0.1. And everyone else's light rays and everyone else's hands are also at A. And so they could go to where you were in the three big dimensions, in their three dimensions. And you would no longer be in that location of those three dimensions, because you've moved in that other dimension. And so that is the essential insight, is that when you have a new dimension to specify, then basically you have a redundancy. So that you can re-describe everything else plus another location. And so it's like time. It's like, so in that way it's sort of like time. And that, you know, right now at 12:15 on the Saturday morning, I'm right here. But if you come back you know, in 45 minutes, and if y'all have y'all aren't still asking questions, then I won't be here. But in these three spatial dimensions, it's still the same spatial location where my body is. So that different location and time, my person will no longer be in this spot, right? And so it's basically the extra dimension is an analogous thing, except for within space. And so that's the new thing that you get with an extra dimension, is this redundancy, this new, you can add more information, essentially. And you can encode in just four, three spatial dimensions. And so that's the best I can answer the question. But don't, if you try to get it in your mind, you're just going to fail. Because it's just, I've been told that there are certain mathematicians who can picture a four-dimensional manifold. I'm not sure I believe it.
It sounds like what I see is at least the
I don't have it. I don't know.
Oh, I think you've got it.
What's it called?
Versus the Amber.
It's just the Amber.
Versus. Yeah. It's all about here. Other worlds, oh, which are not to be moved into. You only, you can
actually. Oh, okay.
You move it, you can move it.
Just in that.
Yeah, if you have extra particles in the extra dimensions, like you have a selectron, do you also have the corresponding antimatter particles, like a S positron?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have everything as a pair. So it's positron. Yeah, everything gets paired. Positrons, it's positron.
Yeah, these gravitons that are escaping from our brain, are they taking energy from them?
Yep.
So there's no conservation of energy there.
Well, I mean, so the thing is that, so as I have now repeatedly reminded you that in gravitating systems, conservation of energy is violating. And I'm not saying that to fuss, but just because it's a very strange concept, so it bears repeating. But in any closed system, conservation of energy is respected. And so, but it's really hard to do an accounting for gravitational energy. And so, if you could, then you would see the energy flowing out. And that'd be a way of verifying the existence of the fifth dimension, if you could do that accounting very precisely. And you could say, do an experiment and watch the energy flow away. But you would have to already know, but that's knowing a priori what the right way of describing it is. But in the absence of knowing that, then you're just gonna get confused. So then yes, the energy does flow out. But it would be, and so in a local closed system, it would be, if you included the fifth dimension or extra dimension, then you would still conserve energy because you just see it go, you just keep track of the stuff that goes into the other dimension. Does that make sense?
Sure. Okay, so it's maybe, a millimeter that we're able to escape.
Yep.
Is there a wall at that millimeter distance? And would
they
reflect off that wall?
No, typically when we describe these, they're closed extra dimensions, so if you go in, you come back out. So it's just
they're the bound state to our brain.
Uh-huh. So yeah, they come back, they go out and they come back in. They just have more space to like just get
well, that's actually detectable.
Exactly, yeah. No, that's why we do observations to see if they're there. If they haven't found them yet. Yes?
If you look at the original closed line idea with the cosmological constant, mm-hmm. Why doesn't that cosmological constant affect the electricity and magnetism?
I don't really know that much about the original closed line theory. So,
you like GU5 is like AU vector field?
Uh-huh.
So it would look like the equations would affect the electricity and magnetism.
Yeah, it does. I mean, I think it does.
The cosmological constant.
I don't know. I'm not sure.
You just look at Einstein's equation. You have G mu nu times lambda. And so it looks like when you take the mu equal 5 component, it looks like you get a contribution to
probably. I don't know. You seem like you know enough to just answer the question yourself. any other questions? Yes, sir.
What is the grain made of?
Well,
electromagnetic properties, is it a woven string?
I mean, I guess in a sense you could think of it as a string condensate, I think is what people let's say. But I mean, when we write it out of the equations, it's just, that's just a fundamental object. It's not made of anything. It's just, it's made of brain. But it has a charge. So remember this. So this is a generalized notion of charge. So it's and so in string theory, it's no longer, the whole goal of string theory is to no longer have to talk about separate forces like electromagnetism, extremely strong force, etc. And so in string theory, there's only the string force. And so there, different brains are charged under the string force, which basically means that they have open strings connecting them. And that's it. Yes?
I'd like to add a historical note
to
your discussions of small particles.
Okay.
In the Middle Ages, they talked about how many angels can dance on the point of a needle. So the idea of very small particles goes back a very long way.
Speculative thinking is one of the indulgences of the human mind. Any other questions for that? Okay.